Well, good afternoon to everybody. If you don't mind, can I make your presentation in English, in Portuguese? It's quite easier for me.
1 minute.
Nós temos dos convidados mais fascinantes destas conferências do Estoril. O nome pode nos parecer mais distante a nós portugueses. O Sr. Brunkaroy é um menino de classe média alta da Índia, estudou em alguns dos melhores colégios da Índia, foi jogador de squash, teve uma vida, direi, passo uma provocação, quase confortável, e de repente largou tudo isso para, há 40 anos atrás, fundar um colégio para meninos que nada tinham. E há 40 anos que faz a gestão desse colégio, o Barefoot College, que a Clara Sousa acabou de falar, e por onde passaram 3 milhões de pessoas para aprenderem coisas tão simples como reparar pequenas máquinas, ou serem arquitetos, ou serem médicos. É uma vida fascinante que vai, de certeza, partilhar algumas das suas experiências. Senhoras e senhores, o Sr. Brunkaroy. Please.
Ladies and gentlemen, 45 years ago, I came out of the most expensive school and college in India, and I was all set to be someone like you. But then, by sheer chance, I went to a famine in Bihar, and I saw starvation and death and hunger for the first time. And it changed my life, because I was all set to be a banker or a bureaucrat or a businessman. And I came back home. And I told my mother that I want to live and work in a village. My mother went into a coma because she couldn't understand what had happened to me in those 1 week that I spent in a village. For the first time, it hit me between the eyes that there was a different country out there which I didn't know, which I should have known. People were dying of hunger. People were living on less than $1 a day. And what was I doing, living in Delhi, going to Zurich, going to London, and being just like anybody else? So 45 years ago, I went to a village for the first time. And my mother said, "What do you want to do in a village?" And I said, "I want to be an unskilled laborer digging wells." That didn't go down well at all. And she didn't speak to me for many years, because she felt I had let my family down by not doing the usual thing that everyone did. But then, my real education started there. So I would like to change the title of this conference. Instead of calling it Global Challenges and Local Answers, the real issue today is the local challenge and the global answer. What are the local challenges today that will be the global answer? Today, you have people on the ground who are living a hand-to-mouth existence, and we are just not looking at them enough. They have tremendous knowledge and skills. Very poor people have tremendous knowledge and skills and wisdom which is dying, which is devalued, which is not being respected, and not even brought into mainstream. So I thought, exposed for 5 years to all these local challenges, that I would like to start a barefoot college only for the poor. Only the poor would be a part of this college. Anyone with a PhD or a master's would be disqualified to come. It would have to be a dropout or a cop out or a washout to come to the college, because we felt that they had knowledge and skills which were unheard of, and they needed to be revived, they needed to be respected, they needed to be brought into mainstream thinking. So we redefined what is a professional. Today, a professional in the eyes of the Barefoot College is someone who has a combination of competence, confidence, and belief. A water diviner, for us, is a professional. A traditional midwife is a professional. A traditional bone setter is a professional. These are people who are respected all over the world in every inaccessible village around the world, and we are not even recognizing them. The water diviner today in Rajasthan, in the deserts of Rajasthan, has a better record than a geophysicist who comes out of 5 years of university. He can see water, you may not believe it, but he sees water. So why aren't we respecting these people and bringing them into mainstream thinking? Thelonia is a small village, 500 miles southwest of Delhi. It's a very small village. We believe, this is a very powerful statement, we believe in this, we actually practice this, we actually see this happening. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And we've been doing this constantly. Why barefoot? Because it is symbolic of millions of people who walk barefoot, who have the traditional knowledge which are dying. Why college? Because it's a place for learning and unlearning. It's a place where the learner is the teacher and the teacher is the learner. And it's a place where we don't give a paper qualification or degree to anybody, because the certification is done by the community you serve, not by the college or university you go to. So when we said that, we actually said, where is it written that just because you can't read and write, you cannot become an engineer, you cannot become an architect, you cannot become a designer, you cannot become a communicator? Where is it written? It's just in our head that we feel you have to learn how to read and write. So when we were making all these crazy statements, they said, prove it. So the Barefoot College in 1986 was built by someone who still can't read and write today. We built it at $1.50 a square foot, and 150 professionals stay there, live there, work there. And when we came up to the roof, I went to this forester, highly qualified, paper qualified forester, and I said, what will grow here? Forester said, look, you've got a lot of hard rock underground and there's no water here and I don't think anything will grow. Then I went to the local man in the village and I said, what do you think I should grow? He gave me some advice and this is what it looks like today. He went to the roof. Then the women said, all the men clear out, because this is the technology we won't share with the men. So they waterproofed my roof with jaggery, urine, God knows what else, but it doesn't leak today. This is what the Barefoot College looks like today. We collect rainwater from the roofs, and they're sitting on an underground tank. 5,000 people can sit on it, and that's where we have our performances. It's the only college in India which is already in the 22nd century. We have optical fiber cable, everything. We have video conferencing from that small village in Rajasthan. We have a speed post service where if you should ever buy some handicrafts from Thelonia, it arrives to you in 7 days. So all these facilities are available, accessible. I'm going to share with you three instances of local challenges, basic all over the world. First is education, but you have to look at education with a difference. Second will be water, and third will be lighting. These are the three basic problems every man, woman, and child living on less than $1 a day faces. 60% of the children don't go to school in India because they can't go to school. They look after cattle, sheep, and goats in the morning. Why should they go to school? So we thought we'd start schools in the evening, at night. So we have night schools of Thelonia. Since 1975, over 75,000 children have gone through these night schools. But we improved them because in those days it was kerosene lamps, now it's all solar. All solar lamps, lighting 225 schools. And 7,000 children go to these schools. It's a school with a difference, because you teach them about the village, not about the country. They teach them about village institutions, not about the laws of the country. They should know more about their village rather than what's happening around in India. But the beauty is that all the 7,000 children have an election, because we think the child should know about democracy, should know about citizenship, should know about elections, who you should actually vote, the right leader, and they have a children's parliament. These are 7,000 children elect a children's parliament, and the children are between 6 and 14 years old. We have a prime minister. The prime minister is 12 years old. She looks after 20 goats in the morning, but she's prime minister in the evening. She has a cabinet, and that's a cabinet. Minister for Education, Minister for Women. And they monitor, supervise their own schools. No adult is allowed. If a prime minister should write to me and say this teacher is misbehaving, or not using the solar lantern properly, or not coming in time, or beating a child, she's fired, he's fired. Because if a prime minister writes, it's serious. So it's a very serious situation, a children's parliament. 6 years ago, the prime minister went to get the World Children's Prize from the Queen of Sweden. Queen of Sweden couldn't believe, that's the prime minister on her left. Couldn't believe that this child could have so much confidence. And the Queen of Sweden turned to me and said, could you find out why, how has this child got so much confidence? She's never left her village. She's gone to Sweden for the first time, and she's acting as if she's been here all her life. So I asked this young child, 12 years old, where did you get your confidence from? She looked at the Queen straight in the eye and said, please tell her I'm the Prime Minister. Where there's no papers, where there are no newspapers, where there's no radio, where there's no television, traditional media is very strong. And we use traditional media to convey social messages. Why you shouldn't beat your wife, why you should go send your child to school, why you should have safe drinking water. This man is Joachim Chacha. He is 300 years old, and he's my doctor, he's my psychoanalyst, he's my teacher, he's my lawyer, he's my donor. He collects all my money for me, solves all my disputes. If there's ever a tension in the village and the child doesn't come to school, Joachim Chacha is called, and he solves all my problems. We have all these puppets which are performing in front of 100,000 people every year. These puppets are made out of recycled World Bank reports. We have a community radio where 50,000 people listen to our radio programs, and they're all barefoot. They have to be semi-literate or illiterate to run all these programs in the Barefoot College, because we want to prove that literacy is not a barrier to developing yourselves or becoming a leader or becoming a role model. We have a dentist, two grandmothers who are dentists, looking after the teeth of 7,000 children. Maybe in 6 months, they will perform a root canal, but they're illiterate. Never underestimate the capacity of women, especially grandmothers. If you should come to the Barefoot College, you will get solar cooked food. Four grandmothers are fabricating solar cookers, and you get 60 meals twice a day through solar cooking. The beauty is that they're almost half German. They're so precise. Indian women are not so precise, but they're so precise with everything. And this solar cooker has a clock, and the clock moves with the sun. Fabricated in the village itself by someone who still can't read and write. Please note, all these people are people who are illiterate. 300 years ago in Rajasthan, see all these beautiful structures on water. No engineer, no architect made this. Beautiful, all for collecting rainwater, because Rajasthan, where I live, sometimes it does not rain for 5 years. But when it rains, should it rain, we collect every drop of water. So We found this dam 300 years old, and the location is perfect. It was, and it fell into disuse, and we had to revitalize it. So we used local materials, local technology, and we built the dam in 1 year. And we collected rainwater in a location which the community selected. This water actually goes underground and it recharges. Can you imagine? If you ask an engineer a solution, he will say, dig a hand pump, go 300 feet, take the water out. Go to the community, they will say, collect rainwater. It's the most sensible way of collecting water. Don't let water go waste. So they collected water, they used the material, benefited 200 villages, over 100,000 people are benefiting from the water, collecting it into the ground, and guess how much it costs. This is 10 kilometers. You see the black mark, which is the dam, and within 10 kilometers, and this is how much it cost, only £25,000. If you had to dig a hand pump, it would cost you £50,000. But with this, people got work, people used their technology, people used their skill, people used their wisdom, and it worked. And they owned it. That's the most important thing. It is also the only college which is fully solar energized. And my first barefoot solar engineer is a Hindu priest looking after a temple. He solar electrified the whole campus. We are now fully self-sufficient in water because we collect rainwater, and we are fully sufficient in power so long as the sun shines. All this is off the solar. And we came to a very profound conclusion. What is the best way of communicating today? Is it telegraph? Is it telephone? Is it television? No, it is telewoman. Today, the Barefoot College has come to a conclusion also that men are untrainable. Men are restless. Men are compulsively mobile. Men are ambitious. And they all want a certificate. And the moment you give a man a certificate in a village anywhere in the world, within 24 hours, he goes to look for a job in a city. So why should you train men at all? So we came to a fantastic conclusion. We started training grandmothers. This woman is our first barefoot solar engineer. And we've trained over 100 women solar engineers in India. Have to be illiterate, have to have never left a village in her life, and they come to the Barefoot College. Only through sign language, not the written word, not the spoken word. In 6 months, we train these women to be solar engineers. And they know more about solar than any graduate after 5 years of university. We went to Ladakh up in the mountains and we said, what is the benefit you've had from solar? And the woman turned to us and said, it's the first time I can see my husband's face in winter. Can you imagine living for 6 months only on candlelight at minus 40 outside? This is what technology is all about. So we've solar electrified villages up in the mountains, we've solar electrified villages in the deserts, and as a result of solar lanterns, over $100,000 of handicrafts have been sold as a result of them creating jobs. Went to Africa. Between 2004 and 2012, we've reached almost the whole continent of Africa. You're talking about globalization, local solutions, and that's your global solution. Get the woman on the ground, teach them a skill that we'll never forget. The best part of being illiterate is that you never forget. Never forget. This is the light they use at night. Unacceptable today in 2013 that every country in Africa uses that light. They've walked for miles. So what is the barefoot approach in Africa? We call the whole community together because it is a transparent, accountable process. Everyone must be involved in the decision making. It can't be made in New Delhi and it can't be made in Washington. It has to be made on the ground. So you bring all them together and they decide how much they will pay for solar if they should get solar. And what they decide is what they already pay for kerosene, candles, torch batteries, and diesel. $5 to $10 within their limits, within their reach, within their resources. So they agree to pay to themselves. Then they get one solar light, three lights, and one mobile charger. The mobile charger is a great hit because everyone has a mobile in Africa. Even if they don't have food to eat, they have a mobile. So they have to have a mobile charger. And they form a committee and monitor the project. So I'm going to show you a very small film. You know, the best part is that the government of India, I have a great deal with the government of India. If I should choose a grandmother from any part of the world, the government of India pays me the airfare and 6 months training costs for the women to come to India. I would like to do that with all the Portuguese colonies here. San Lomé, wherever. Why do you have grandmothers? They all sit in one table, but they don't understand a word because they're speaking French, they're speaking Jola, they're speaking Wolof, but their body language is great. And they all want to learn. And I tell them, you are the ambassadors of your country. Don't forget, you can't fail. And they get charged up. They'll never forget. They will make sure that, and I have had 300 grandmothers in Africa, and not one has failed me. They are the only solar engineers of Africa, only.
This is a true story about ordinary heroes. This is about very simple rural women in Africa. From the Congo to Senegal, from Mauritania to Mozambique, from Liberia to Tanzania, from Sudan to South Africa, a quiet revolution is taking place. Illiterate and semi-literate rural grandmothers who have never left their villages in their lives are proving the impossible is possible. By the hands-on approach, they are baffling high-powered engineers, universities, donors, development planners, and paper-qualified experts by demonstrating incredible sophisticated technology skills and exposing the fundamental weaknesses of the formal educational system. Without using the written or spoken word, they have come to India to be trained in 6 months to be solar engineers. Unlike the university and other based training centers that are all theory and no practice, it is not surprising these women know more about practical installation, fabrication, repair and maintenance than any paper qualified, certified solar engineer after 5 years. These women represent the profile of everyday rural Africa, from poor agricultural communities, housewives, daily wage laborers, midwives, shopkeepers, all now recognized and respected leaders in their own communities. They have no knowledge of theory, of mathematics, physics, or electronics. They have no idea of the names of any spare parts and have never heard of generating power from the sun. But in 6 months, using only sign language, they can install a solar unit on the roof and fabricate a solar lantern and shame any paper-qualified solar engineer into silence. What is extraordinary is that they have solar electrified each house in their villages all on their own. As a result of 12 women being trained in India as solar engineers in 2011, the president of Sierra Leone has constructed the first barefoot training center in Conteline in Africa. It was inaugurated in March 2012. 12 barefoot women solar engineers trained in India are now training 150 solar grandmothers from all over the country. When the 6 simple, rural, illiterate solar grandmothers returned to Burkina Faso, they were received as heroes. 4 cabinet ministers, the UNDP resident representative, and the entire national press were there at the airport. The prime minister received them. The Barefoot approach believes the management, control, and ownership of the technology must lie in the hands of the poor communities. They must take all major decisions, like how much they are prepared to pay as a monthly contribution, and who among the poorest of the poor women should go for training as a Barefoot solar engineer. When the target is the poorest of the poor, earning less than 50 cents a day, it is unreal and practical to talk about business models. The partnership model is by far the most sustainable model. Poor communities in all these countries in Africa have agreed to pay what they now pay for kerosene, wood, candles, torch batteries, and diesel. Depending on the economic status, they have agreed to pay between $5 to $10 a month per solar unit, even in the least developed countries. This is a fundamental breakthrough because nothing should be free. The Barefoot approach does not believe in issuing certificates or diplomas after training. The certification should be done by the community themselves. That is why we believe men are untrainable. They are restless, ambitious, compulsively mobile, and they all want a certificate so that they can leave their villages looking for a job in the city. None of the nearly 246 illiterate grandmothers trained as solar engineers who have solar electrified a total of 13,200 houses from nearly 32 countries all over Africa have left their villages. So what are the universal lessons we have learned from training poor, illiterate rural women as solar engineers in Africa? Lesson one. Any illiterate rural grandmother from any part of Africa can be trained in 6 months in India to be a confident and competent Barefoot solar engineer.
Yes, me, I feel proud because solar engineer is good to lady. Now I'm feeling good because I'm original training solar engineer.
Lesson two. Sensitize the community first by involving them in taking all major decisions and only then bring in the solar technology to the village, a genuine community-based bottom-up approach. Lesson three, keep all urban-based paper-qualified engineers away. They have neither the vision nor the courage nor the faith to select and train women as solar engineers. They also do not have the communication tools to speak as equals with poor communities. Lesson four. No certificates should be issued. None of the grandmothers from any country in Africa have asked for them. Solar electrifying each house in the village is certification enough. Lesson five. To reach the very poor, only a bottom-up partnership model can work. The top-down business model for the very poor in Africa has failed. The cost of solar electrifying villages by nearly 246 women solar engineers all over Africa is close to $3.9 million, less than the amount being wasted on 2 millennium villages, on brick and mortar, on salaries and consultancies, on travel, on publicity and preparing studies and papers. The solar grandmothers as of today have solar electrified 13,200 houses in 195 villages. They are the only solar engineers trained in Africa. The first technically and financially self-sufficient solar electrified villages in the whole continent of Africa, indeed the world. On a rare visit to the Barefoot College, when he also spent the night, His Holiness the Dalai Lama blessed the women solar engineers on the 13th of February 2011.
That's secret. So those illiterate villagers, even grandmother, see, physically also a little bit old and illiterate. Yet, see, through training, as an engineer, proud, self-confidence and dignity. Wonderful.
By 2013, the Indian government has brought rural women from Sudan and Southern Sudan, from Liberia, Senegal, Zimbabwe, Ivory Coast, Togo, Comoros, Madagascar, and Zanzibar, almost all the least developed countries in the whole continent of Africa will be covered, saving 2 million liters of kerosene from polluting the environment and thousands of tons of wood from being cut, depleting the already fragile forest. There is no question. The barefoot approach is here to stay. What Mahatma Gandhi said comes to mind. First they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, and then you win.
We have also trained grandmothers from the Pacific. 20 grandmothers have just come back from the 7 Pacific Islands, so it's almost global. The grandmother barefoot model is global. And we have support, and we need all the support we can get to get many more grandmothers. 54 of the least developed countries have been identified by the UN, and we're only in 34, so we've got a long way to go. And some of them are in the ex-Portuguese colonies. So we need to have you. When he came, he said something very profound, and I'll end with that. He said, now that you've shown the Barefoot College working in practice, let's see if the professors and experts can make it work in theory. Can't, you're doing everything wrong, and yet something's coming out right. Thank you.
Wonderful. That's a wonderful work, really. A lifetime achievement, of course. Before we go to the audience to some questions, I have some questions to make you. The first of all is, let me get this clear. So you have a college with a degree, but no diplomas, with no certificates, really?
With competence and no paper qualification.
No paper, no diploma in the end.
Not allowed.
That would be very useful here in Portugal, but let me make another question. So you have only poor people, right? Illiterate people.
Living on less than $1 a day.
And if I wanted to study there, I couldn't.
You would have to leave your degree behind. You'll have to come with humility and the willingness to learn.
So,
and that is very difficult when you've gone through a formal educational system. You always want to teach someone. You know, there's a tendency to wanting to teach someone just because you've gone through a school and college. This is a myth, because you have a lot to learn from those people who are living in these communities.
But you have a model based on equality, right? So
equality, non-negotiable, equality, justice, decision-making, collective decision-making, and simplicity. No one in the Barefoot College can get more than $150 a month, because you haven't come for the money, you've come for the challenge.
Because you believe money can ruin a person?
I believe money has corrupted people. And I don't think money is the main issue. I don't think just because you've gone through a degree or a qualification, you deserve that money until you prove it. And that proof is when you mix with these people and see whether it's possible. In the Barefoot College, should I make a mistake and take someone who's got a degree, I say for 6 months you have to do nothing. Nothing. Just sit and listen to other people. They break. They can't stay and do nothing. But you're used to 100 miles per hour, and all of a sudden you come to 0 miles per hour in a village. Nothing works, nothing moves, nothing. And you feel that, you know, you're wasting your time. Actually, you're not wasting your time, because you're under a test. Everyone is looking at you. Have you got a sense of humor? Can you last out in a situation which is critical? Someone is laughing at you. Can you bear that? All these are tests for these people who come. And it's a very difficult test.
Is there a lot of people, rich people, that have tried to study there in the Barefoot College?
No, not a lot, no.
But you already tested a few?
Quite a few.
Do you want to share with us the experience of having someone like us studying there?
Well, it wasn't money, but John Kennedy came for 1 week. And I asked John, I said, he came with these fluffy shoes, and he said, the American ambassador said, no, he can wear those shoes. I said, John, I don't think those shoes will work in a village. He said, no, I'll wear it. So the next day he walked into a thorn, and he was limping away all the And I said, John, I told you. He said, oh, well, now I want to go to a village where they haven't seen a white man. So
We took him to a village which is 60 kilometers away. And John John was limping away. And a villager came to him and said, I want to ask you a personal question. I said, yeah. Do all the Americans walk like that? We've had McNamara coming for a night. We've had McBon Bundy coming. So.
But nobody.
We've had Prince and the Princess of Wales coming to Thelonia. So.
But someone trying to do the complete study, education program?
Difficult.
Let's hear from some questions from the audience. Milton, please. There's a microphone missing.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Sanjit. I have one question, because some of the solutions you actually have in there require high tech. So to some extent, they require advanced knowledge about solar energy and some level of fundamental research. How do you see these two elements of knowledge coexisting? Because you have, on one hand, I would say, the need at the same time to have a system that can come up with these things and a system to apply it locally. You seem to very much focus on the application of that technology. How do you see, for a country like Portugal, for instance, that seems we kind of fell in love with technology somehow, with high tech, and lost touch with reality, how do you see these two worlds coexisting?
We started on the premise that you must never underestimate someone who hasn't gone through a formal education. And I think they have the capacity and competence to be able to absorb and handle the most sophisticated technology. We've seen it happening in front of our eyes. I think we make too much out of sophisticated technology. I asked a solar engineer, can you make a charge controller, which is a very sophisticated piece of solar equipment? And the solar engineer says, it's not possible. It's technically impossible unless you make it in a laboratory. And I say that a grandmother in Niger is making this, and he can't believe it. It's beyond his comprehension. He can't believe that someone can do this. So I think it is to set an example is most important. You mix the traditional with the modern, and it's possible. If you have the mental and physical space to be able to let people grow, anything is possible. And I've seen this happening. And I don't think we should be hung up on the certification issue. This is something which I see very, very serious about. We must let people grow and must not penalize anyone just because they have not gone through school and college. Because there are millions of people who are on the sideline who really need to get into mainstream and provide the work and the services that they can do. And I think they have to do it in a village because that's where they need it the most. So we have actually reversed migration by several hundred thousand just over the 40 years by making them provide that service to the community at large. This is the answer today. Not urbanize rural areas or ruralize urban areas, but there is only a rural solution to a rural problem. There's not an urban solution to a rural problem. This is.
Some more questions. Let me make you another question. You educate people, right? So you have a college in the middle of a desert, like I said, in the desert province of India. Are you substituting yourself to the government of India? Are you doing their job?
If I told the government of India precisely what I was doing, they'd be horrified. But they see the result. They see the result of these grandmothers going back and solar electrifying the villages, and the community is putting pressure on their government to find this grandmother power to come back and see that more villages are solar electrified. So it's the pressure from below that's going to change policy above. And today there are 5 or 6 countries who have officially requested the government of India for a barefoot training center to train more grandmothers. Remember, grandmothers in Africa are between 35 and 50. Don't think they're 60, 70. You are a grandmother very young in Africa. And that's the best age that you'd catch them. They're respected, they're highly. And there are so many stories of grandmothers, the husband saying, look, if you go to India, you will not come back because I'll take another wife. You know, what is this thing, going to India and God knows what's going to happen to you, are you going to come back or not? They come back, solar electrify the whole village, and the husband says, please come back. Oof,
And some of the women have said, no, thank you very much. I don't want to be with you. I'm quite happy as I am. And there have been lots of offers in Burkina Faso. Was it Burkina Faso, Megan? In Burkina Faso, there are 5 or 6 men in the village offering the woman, saying, can you marry me? And she said, no, I'm quite happy now. I'm very well settled and highly respected, because they have gone to India and back. It's a magical place. Every grandmother is dragged screaming onto the plane because they hate the idea. Where are they going? They're so old, they're illiterate, strange food, strange language, strange country, strange weather, can't speak my language for 6 months. Can you imagine the courage these people have? I couldn't do it, no one could do it. Incredible. But they went, and not one of them have actually, they hated in the first month, and they're all crying when they come back because they don't want to go, they want to stay. I said, no, you have to go back. No
way. But isn't it strange? Well, we pay thousands and thousands of euros or rupiahs in taxes, and then we end up having Bunker Roy doing the job that the government should do. Bunker Roy is all over the world. Is it normal? Is it something failing in our education
Barefoot
system?
Barefoot College is not all over the world. Every not grandmother yet. Is a walking, talking Barefoot College. Remember that. She has the mindset, she's clear, she's a role model, she's leadership qualities, and she has shown that she can change the men-women relationship in a village, in a traditional society. When we trained this grandmother from Afghanistan, and she solar electrified the first village ever in Afghanistan, and she went and sat with the men said, what do you think you're doing? You shouldn't be sitting next to me. I mean, you should be sitting with all the men, with the women about 1 kilometer away. And she said something very quietly. She said, today, I'm not a woman, I'm an engineer. And I've solar electrified a village. And all of a sudden, it hit them between the eyes. They said, my God, you are an engineer? Yes, you have every right to sit here. She changed a tradition which is thousands of years old just by quietly, gracefully, non-violently sitting next to the men to prove a point that they're equal. And I think that's the way to do it. Prove a point, set an example, and leave the courage and the grace to the women. They'll do it. You don't have to tell them what to do. They know exactly.
In the movie, you were talking about the movie talked about changing things from the top to bottom, if I'm not mistaken, because the bottom to top models have failed. Can you explain that?
A business model, the transaction is very impersonal. I sell you a product, and once you give me the money, it's over. That is not the model that will be sustained.
Microcredit, for example?
Maybe, but today, you have to build the capacity and competence of women, which is a partnership model. There's a partnership between the community, between the government, and between the Barefoot College, where the partnership is sustained by a constant interaction. It is not someone making a profit in Delhi by selling a product. It is actually circulating the money within the community, where the community controls the money. This is the important thing. In a microcredit, yes, there are many models in microcredit, and sometimes it's the bank that comes in. Here, the bank doesn't come in other than putting the money into the bank and that the community controls. So the answer is, how do you get the group together? You see, they're saying, if you look, we've solar electrified thousands of houses. How have you done it? You've done it through a central model. You've got a solar power plant, and the solar power plant has wires into every house and a meter. That's not the model that's going to work, because you're dependent on an engineer to look after the repair and maintenance. The Barefoot model, you have a panel on every roof, and every member of the community is a part of this whole process. Something goes wrong, she summons the grandmother, who is within 1 hour, and she goes and repairs it. She does all the major and minor repairs. Please remember, she is an engineer. So you have the first technically and financially self-sufficient solar electrified villages in India, in the world. Yes, Matt. Yes, sir.
Thinking of taking this out further, for example, agriculture. Very many times in Africa, you talked about water, but we have famine and we have this. If we could teach people how to use the soil that's around them in a more efficient way, because you've only talked about technology, Are you looking at this in terms of the agricultural sense as well?
We are training the grandmothers not only to put up individual units, but also to maintain and install solar power plants. And you need solar power plants for solar pumping. That is what we are looking forward to. But we're also, for instance, in the Pacific, looking at solar-operated reverse osmosis plants so that the salt water is converted into sweet water. And Pacific has big problems of drinking water. So it's a solar-operated reverse osmosis plants which can work very effectively. So we're not only thinking of lighting at the house, because we have found that as a result of 3 hours more of light, the income levels of many people have gone up. People have written to me saying, thank you very much for the solar lights. For the first time in the history, we don't have snakes and scorpions and rats in our house. Most of them have got these serious problems. In Ethiopia, I asked them, what did you do? And they said they gave a solar lantern to every traditional midwife. So 500 babies have been delivered of solar lanterns. Otherwise, they'd be doing it in the fireside and through candles. So the quality of life is improved just by opening their eyes. And we have never suggested anything to them. On their own, they have actually improvised and gone further.
Any more questions with the audience? Let me make you over there, Lorin Alves.
Hi, and what about your mother? Is she convinced?
My mother softened when she heard that the Prince and Princess of Wales was coming to Thelonia. She's a bit of a snob. She was a bit of a snob. So when the Prince and Princess of Wales, that was the last time they were seen together, was in Thelonia. And so she relented. She did soften. But it took time. 15 years.
Now, let me make you a final question. You are called a social...
There's one question there.
Perfect.
So. Was there one there?
Thank you. Yes, if you don't mind, I would like to, I think it's the same question, but divided in two. I think the first is a bit positive, the second a bit negative. The first, I would like to ask you to expand a little bit. You touched upon it, but perhaps not enough. By taking like a technical and capacity-based approach, I think it's excellent being like a development student, not taking a financial approach, because for example, that Bangladeshi gentleman who was so lauded by the World Bank and his microcredit approach, it turns out that it was just inserting communities into financial systems which they couldn't cope with, and it just made them go even more into debt. So I would like to expand how connected your capacity-based approach is to financial mechanisms and what its relation is potentially to microcredit. And the second one, I would like to ask you, to what extent by providing, what is the danger? It's almost a criticism. What is the danger that by giving otherwise disconnected communities who are disconnected from the global market, by giving them only technical and capacity-based approach and not academic, you know, critical capacities, are you not potentially opening up new pools of labor for global capital to come and exploit? Because that could be a potentially negative effect. Thank you.
I'll answer the last question first. Every illiterate grandmother who came back home after the solar course went to the NGO and said, I want to learn how to read and write, because for the first time I understand how important it is. So they have run literacy classes for the women for the first time, how to learn how to read and write, which has been a good spin-off. When you demystify technology and you open up areas and open up their vision and open up their imagination in what is possible in 6 months, they come up with their solutions on their own. They are entrepreneurs. You don't have to nudge them or push them into any areas. They are already entrepreneurs. They are buying and selling. They are providing their service. They are selling the service. It's not free. So every community has to pay between $5 to $10, which is put into the bank. And 30% of that goes into the salary of the barefoot women engineer. Now we are trying to bring out some more panels and lanterns for these women to be able to sell and become entrepreneurs in the village itself. And they are open to that idea. So the microcredit idea has not really been forced down their throat. They come up with their own indigenous model, which seems to work and acceptable to all. We will not interfere with that sort of model.
One final question then. You had 3 million students, right? Going
3 million people who we've given work to all over the country in 40 years.
3 million people in a country of millions and millions and millions and millions. Do you think, looking back, that your work
What's the
makes
population
a difference?
Of Portugal, Portugal?
10 million. So it's almost a third of our population.
That's one street of Calcutta.
Very small streets, I can imagine.
Big street.
So 3 million in a country of millions and millions and hundreds of millions of poor people. Does your work make really a difference?
Every day, when I know that I'm making a difference to people tangibly in their lives, whether it's a hand pump, whether it is a night school, whether it is giving people jobs, whether it's giving them the skill, it's a great source of satisfaction. And people say, what makes me tick and what makes me survive is these little acts of courage which you see. And the only thing you can support them. I keep telling all my people when they get depressed, you know how powerful you are? You're more powerful than the Prime Minister of India. They said, what? Prime Minister of India can't open a night school tomorrow like you can. Prime Minister of India can't train a woman like you can. I mean, you are more powerful. You are the change agents of this country, not the Prime Minister. So you should know how valuable and important and relevant and urgent your work is. And that makes them feel a bit better. My job is to make them feel that they are a very important part of society. And it's the rural change at the bottom that's going to make a global change on the top. No other way. No other way.
And it's a wonderful job. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Sanjit Munkerroy.